is a shame to interrupt the sound.
The sound, I know. Yeah. That sound goes to eternity.
Does it?
Mm-hmm.
Sister Elaine, you, well, striking this gong is a thing you have done a lot of times and are still doing. You've quite an interesting life story.
Yes, I've had a wonderful life. And I read the other day that old age is for tying up loose ends. And I think I'm doing quite a lot of that. And it's fun. The Japanese say I'm in my biju year, which is 77. And that's a year of joy and happiness. So I'm in the middle of that now.
It's nice to hear
ringing
some,
dong, yeah. Gongs is part of it.
Mm. It's nice to hear something very positive about old age, which seems to be in our times rather to be looked upon as something negative.
Yeah, well, that's not here. Mm. I enjoy every day very much. Yes.
Where were you born?
I was born by the sea in eastern Canada, those many years ago. And the four provinces now that are down, jutting out into the Atlantic Ocean. So in all those years since, I take a pocket of the sea with me everywhere I go.
Why?
Well, there's something alive in the sea. There's something, my new book is going to be called Living Water. Mm-hmm. That the vitality of the sea and its, and I think when I got in Zen and heard the lovely saying, the joy of the raindrop is to enter the ocean, that said it all for me and tied me right back to my beginnings too.
What are your best childhood memories?
Oh, I had a happy childhood and filled with music, of course. Professionally, I'm a violinist, and we had a family orchestra. And my mother and brother and I played violin, and my older sister played piano. And it was a lot of fun. And we played at different small affairs we were invited to. And of course, as children, we didn't want to, and we would hide the music and all the things children do to make it difficult for our parents. But but I look at it, back at it now, I have nothing but happy memories of a childhood.
But when did you for the first time discover that life was not as beautiful as you had expected?
Well, excuse me, we're going to have that's yeah. A tough one.
Yeah, you know. It is.
I don't know what to do with it. I was engaged and very young, and my it was during the war, and he was killed, and that's very hard.
He was killed in the war.
That was a tough one. Mm. And he was English, and he came from Lincolnshire, and I go up there a lot. His family are still very good to me, but that was a tough lesson to learn at that age. I was just 19 at that time. But when you love life, you pick up and go.
But what did you learn from that?
Well, I was young, and I learned there's always a tomorrow. And if I could just cope with the day as it went. And in time, I became very peaceful about it, and to this day, it's a lovely memory.
But did you recall rebelling against God or against life?
No, I seem to have been totally accepting. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think one of the reasons why, well, I can see now, I had there were other doors going to open for me, and I had there was one. One avenue I wanted to pursue, which opened for me, my gap year between high school and university. And I did a lot of reading at that time. And I just became aware of an inner longing. You know, they say the Celtic people have it very strongly. And I'm of Scottish origin. The Highlands of Scotland is where my people come from. And that longing in the heart, I think, was probably it was my friend's death at that time that made me more aware of it. And I was just kind of determined to assuage that in some way. First, I thought I was going to do it through philosophy. When I was at, just before I went to university, of course, it was decided I was going to take music. And
violin player.
Violin, yes. Yeah. And I said to my mother, I think I'd like to study philosophy. Well, she looked at me. She says, what is philosophy? I said, I don't know. But I said, I have a couple of questions. I know it deals with ideas in some way. And I think I can find the answer there. So anyway, we didn't have enough money for me to start. I had half my degree off, as it was, just because of my where I was in music and whatnot. So it was decided that I would finish my music degree, and then if I wanted to go in philosophy after that, I'd be on my own. So when I went out to Calgary, Alberta, which is a lovely Canadian city at the mm-hmm. foothills of the Rocky Mountains, and they... I met one of the first people I met playing in the orchestra beside me was a young philosopher. And we became very, very good friends. And one time I was at his home and I asked him to go through all the main philosophers and tell me just two or three sentences about each one. Mm-hmm. So he did. He should have thrown the books at me, you know, but anyway, the question like that. But he did, very kind. And at the end of his recital,
yes.
I knew that that wasn't answering the longing that was in there. And I said, I don't think it's philosophy I want. And he said, Elaine, perhaps you want the real thing. And... So that
the real
that,
thing.
The real thing, yes. So of course I didn't know what the real thing was either, but we were very close friends, and he was the same age as I was, and he was as idealistic as I was, and so we were trying to figure this out together. And I suppose we both thought that both of us being Catholics, that there would be some way to enter a religious order, and so that's what happened. He went into the Holy Cross Fathers. He didn't stay, but he went for a while. And then I came to Our Lady's Missionaries. And there's so much in my temperament not amenable to religious life. And I had, and I was 30 years old when I entered.
Was that the reason, this inner longing to become a nun?
Yes. When I was 10 years old, I had my brother and sisters and I, we all took sick at the same time. And my mother came into it one day with the tray, and she left glass with two thermometers in it. She said, I'll take your temperature in a minute, I have to go somewhere. So mother left the glass with the two thermometers in there, and I took them and started to play with them. And of course I broke them. And that left me two little balls of mercury to play with. And I couldn't get over the attraction they had for each other. I remember holding one behind each of my thumbs and just seeing how close I could bring them together, but eventually they just jumped.
Yes.
And then to get them apart again was almost impossible. But I had a great time. Anyway, I don't recommend other people to do it. It's mercury, of course, is a non-touch element. But anyway, as I say, then 30 years later, when I had this opening experience in Zen, that came back to me very, very strongly. As it was just like those two balls of mercury there, the attraction so strong that they had to come together.
Mm-hmm.
And so that gave me understanding of what this longing was within me, you know.
You associate it with a longing, the longing you had in your heart.
It's a tendency to union, I think, yes.
But what kind of union? Which union?
Well, it's identification. That's where the saying, the joy of the raindrop is to enter the ocean. That's what, and in one of the books we prepared for our prisoners to teach the meditation, one of the illustrations shows the ocean and a drop coming in, and the ocean seems to come up a little bit to, it's a very close up, it comes up just a little bit to welcome the drop. It's very, very nice.
Can you say that it is identification with what? What union with what?
The great unknowable, unnameable, absolute, infinite. Yamada Roshi, the very fine Zen teacher I had, he, his experience caused him always to use the word the infinite. And I used to tease him. I said, "You're getting awfully close to Christian terms when you say that." And he said, "Well, in my experience," he said, "the this power was an infinite power." And he said, "I think that's the if we have to put it in words, that says it better for me than anything else."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you see differences here with Christianity, or do you say it's about the same power we're talking about?
Oh yes, there's only one power. There's only one power. Yes, and the other thing, if I may go back to something that happened in my youth, and having to do with my birth, I was born on the 7th of March, and in the old church calendar, that was the feast of Thomas Aquinas. And I was told that he was a wonderful intellect and a great saint, and that he would look after me. And I was probably 8 or 9, and I went to a bookstore with a friend, and I saw a book up there with Aquinas on it. And I pulled it down and flipped it open, and on the lower right-hand corner, there was something, now I can't remember the exact wording, but it was something of ways to demonstrate the existence of God. And it said the first one had to do with movement. They say you can see movement all around, things are moving, but something causes it to move. And that when you take this back to the origin, the first cause of moving, or as he said, the prime mover, that we call God. And that had an enormous effect on me, mostly because of the first thing I'd read of Aquinas, and I had, you know, I had fully believed that he was going to look after me. And secondly, I never went through the stages of the other people growing up spiritually in what their concept of God was. God was never a concept for me. It was always a power, a moving power, a prime mover. And then when I got into Zen and I got that moving of those mercury and the moving of the ocean, you see how they're all together? It's all part of this dynamism and this potential and this lifing is the word I use. It's a verb. And I'm delighted to hear that the word Yahweh is a verb and not a noun. And so gradually, I have come to, through, thanks to Zen, I've come to see everything in the world as a verb.
Mm-hmm.
It's
power.
Full of. I think the Kensho experience gave me a couple of adjectives to use with that power, mm-hmm. too. The very, very pure, very beautiful, joyful power.
You say the Kensho experience. What is it?
It's seeing your own nature. That Ken is the Japanese word to see, and sho is the is your own nature, and it would be. I've been reading a lot about the relationship in India now between the Brahman and Atman, and it would be the Atman, you see, and the transcendental God, they would call, or the power, they would call the Brahman. And then, of course, experiences, you find they're one. Yamada Roshi, who was an outstanding teacher, my Zen teacher, would just say, that, you know, they're separate entities, and
Buddhism and Christianity.
Yes, they're different religions, and they have their own philosophy and theology attached, and those will he felt they will never meet. The Dalai Lama says something the same too. Yamada Roshi very very clearly. Felt that our meeting place with Christianity, between Christians and Buddhists, I put it that way, was in the field of religious experience, and I to this day I've been sitting since I went to Japan. That's 40 years ago, and I still don't know very much about the Buddhist religion, and I was never told I had to. To learn very much about that. And the Roshi used, of course he used some Buddhist terms, mm-hmm. but he also had other terms. As much as to, as I said, his expression, his own personal expression for the Kensho experience was an experience of the empty infinite.
The Kensho experience is the enlightenment.
Yes. Now that would be a word we wouldn't use.
I think that's a very
misleading word.
Yeah.
And I think many of the problems now, even today, is in our use of words.
Yes.
You know, it's in some ways it's clear to me how. Because I know that meditation, Christian meditation and Buddhist meditations are different. I do them both every day. I start off with zazen and sitting in that, and then when I've finished as much as I want to do, then I go to Christian meditation and I take the words of the mass usually.
Mm-hmm. And but you don't mix them.
You can't. One is. One is built on words and thoughts and feelings and all the wonderful spiritual faculties that we have. But they are those that's the way our mind works. Is it creates an object, you see. And of course, we make the object something very desirable. It can be Christ. It can be mm-hmm. Our Lady. It can be a virtue or something like that. But in Buddhist meditation, we're in the world of silence, and there are no thoughts, no images at all. And the, as I said, the experience is something like a drop of water going into the ocean. Mm-hmm. When you can finally rid yourself of all the images the mind wants to think about, you know, and you're just in the midst of this ocean, I guess, if mm-hmm. I can use that term.
Well, why should we try to do that? Why should we try to rid ourselves of all the images? What is religious?
Well, I think
about
if
that?
You excuse me,
what is specifically religious about trying to get rid of all the images?
Well, that's just a means of getting to the. To the goal, which is to experience the infinite. Anyone who wants an experience of God has to go into silence, where there are no images. There's no other way of getting there. And all the Christian mystics and somebody like Thomas Aquinas, if I may speak of my favorite saint, you know, he's always said from the beginning, we can't know God. God is not accessible to our intellect, And so we have to silence that. And then when all things are ready, I don't think, Lucette, I don't think anybody has all the answers. Yamada Roshi, you know, would always say, we don't know how it works, we don't know why it works, but it works. And if you want to come to experience, this is what you have to do. You have to go into, you have to go into silence, which will put you into a deeper state of consciousness.
Well, you had to go to Japan to find that deeper experience.
Yes,
does that mean that we lost it or never had it in Christianity?
Oh no, I think very much we had it. I have now been trained how to recognize Kensho, and part of that recognition is done by the way people articulate what they have experienced. And you take somebody like Eckhart, and John of the Cross to a certain extent. And I mean, there it's very obvious that they have been gifted in that way.
I want to talk about your work in prison. You teach meditation in Oxford, in Canada, too?
I retired when I was 75 from the Prison Phoenix Trust here. And so I don't go in on a regular basis anymore, which I'm very sad to say, because I'd give anything still to be going back to prisons. I think some of the happiest moments of my life were to be sitting in silence with prisoners. That we had, I think, of course, the cream of the crop. They're prisoners who had nothing to lose, who had, you know, they had lost everything in life, and they perhaps were facing long sentences or what, and they just wanted to believe in themselves, I think, really.
You call them the cream of the crop. Others would call them criminals.
I know. Hardened criminals is the word politicians like to use. Lucette, I never met a hardened criminal. I never met one.
But they got into jail.
Yeah.
Well, what happened then?
They're human beings who had a hard, had a tough life. Everyone I met had a very, very unfortunate family situation when they were young.
But are you saying that all the criminals come from weak social environment?
And I'm saying they come from very poor.
Yeah.
And most of them have seen a lot of violence in their homes, yes, very much so. Yeah. A lot of beatings and received it themselves. It's just dreadfully sad. I told you I'm going to prison in a couple of weeks to see an old friend. And I mean, he was, his mother committed suicide when he was two, and he seems to have something of that has been with him all his life. He absolutely goes berserk when he has to deal with a friend or somebody who has committed suicide. Then his father kicked him out, who's an alcoholic, kicked him out of the house when he was four. So he was, you know, just, he was put in a home, and then I think he was in eight homes before he was 12. And then he just ran out of the last one. He was so unhappy where whatever home he was in, and joined a group of boys on the street. And he armed robbery when he was 14, he was involved in. And he said, and I've worked with him very closely. I went to my first Christmas in England. I was a little bit lonesome, and I thought I better go to prison. So I very hard to visit on Christmas Day because they try to give the guards some time off. But I got the little pull, and I was allowed to go up and see this friend of mine on Christmas Day, and it was up north. And when I got there, I found out that he was in another special jail within the prison. That he had he was a cook. And that he'd been allowed out Christmas morning, and he threw, boy, he got mad at one of the others, prisoners, and he threw a pot of boiling water over him, at 70% body burns, so they had to call the local police in, and they were expected any minute. Now, I was, there I was in the middle of all this, And that was quite a lesson for me, I can tell you. Poor this fellow came in to see me, and he had scuffling along, his shoes were all untied, and he was holding up his pants. They're always afraid people like that are going, if there's anything they can commit suicide with, might do it. So that's always taken away from him, and you know, and trying to appear respectable before me, and oh, I felt so sorry for him. And then he had to leave to meet with the police, and then he came back again. So I followed him for years, and I got him into a therapeutic prison eventually, and he was much, much better there. And there was one little incident when the first time I visited him at the therapeutic prison, when the bell went, we had to go. He got up and was taking his jacket off the back of his chair, and I wanted to give him a little hug. And I got a little bit closer to him and accidentally touched him. You never touch a prisoner without telling them first or letting them see, you know.
Yeah.
And he swung around and, oh, he just missed me by a hair's breadth. And the guard, the officer who was in charge, he came right over and he blamed me. I said, "You're right. I should never have done that. I'm sorry and I apologize." And of course, my little friend just felt terrible when he saw what he almost did, you know. But he was in that prison for 18 months. I went every month to see him. His last visit there, my last visit to him, he had invited me out to, all the men in the wing were have invited a friend out for supper. They made a supper and I went to it. So at the end of it, when the bell went, we were supposed to leave, I went up to shake hands with him again, and he stood back like that. And then he opened his arms and gave me the hug, the first time he'd ever been able to do that.
Was he on your meditation group?
Yes. Yeah.
What did it mean to him, meditation?
Well, I think he was, of course it helped him enormously, but he was so badly damaged that he's a person all his life is going to need somebody beside him or over him who understands him and can help him, you know. Mm-hmm. Some of the prisoners are really badly crippled. He'll never be able to walk alone, I don't think. And anyway, when I was back in Canada, I found he was back in prison again. And so I'm going to hope to see him in another couple of weeks.
Yeah. Can you say in general maybe what can Zen do in prisons? Do you see the effect or the years?
I'm sorry, I haven't clarified that. I don't teach Zen in prison as I just teach silent meditation. Because Zen, as you know, when we work with koans, they're slightly abrasive, and the last thing in the world prisoners need is something more abrasive than they had before.
So you teach them to be silent.
Just to silent, to be the breath, you see, then. Which I think is the perfect living out of what we see in some of our mass prayers. In him we live and move and have our being. That is getting into the ocean of God and just being the breath there. Mm. That's the first action of the Holy Spirit, after all, isn't it? Because I don't say all of this, you. I have, most of the people I work with have no religion, certainly in prisons.
I want to still ask some questions about silencing the body and the mind. Why is body so important, the posture of the body so important in Oriental meditation?
Because the body is very important to us. I think we're starting to realize, because we're becoming very interested in food now and our diet, aren't we? Most people, I get an awful lot of this. And our body is very important to us. And, you know, for this time on earth, we are our bodies. And our body is infused with Buddha nature, as you know, as the Roshi said to me one day, "Don't you think God's in your little fingertip?" You know, and I looked at him like that for a while. I wasn't sure, and because we never think of that, you know. He says, "Well, where do you think God is?" And I was, you know, going to point somewhere in here, as most Westerners would, I think.
Heart.
But you know, but he just kept a little fingertip, and gradually, as I said, if everything's a verb, we are too, and this. Power-filled activity we call life is, our whole body is enlivened. So in a Zendo, that's why we have such a nice bell. We try to help people become the sensual people they're meant to be. We have these senses, and they're meant to receive. You know, my mother was a wood artist, and when I was just little, she said to me once, if you see a nice piece of wood, and you want to touch it, she said, touch it. And she said, receive what it has to give you. Now that's lovely to teach you.
What does that wood give you then? What you touched, you just touched.
That's a connection. And then she was trying to teach me reciprocity, one of the chapters in my new book.
A connection with what?
Yes, two pieces of mercury. Inner life and inner life. It's all so simple, Lucette. Very, very simple. Yeah. And we can build up blocks so these connections happen.
But Elaine, if it is so simple, why is it so hard to silence the body and the mind?
Because we're born Westerners in a culture that did a lot of good, as a matter of fact, you know. Our religion had beauty, truth and goodness. Those are the three pillars that we're built on, and those are things that have added enormously to my life, you know. And I treasure them and cherish them to this very second. But I think we're at a time in history now where we're going to meet, and it's the inner life that needs to be revealed, I think, to the West. I don't think it was meant to happen before this.
Mm. Well, Sister Elaine, I want to thank you in the first place for your gift and sharing it with us. Mm. Could you strike the gong maybe?
Yes.
As
and I'd like to thank you and the other gentlemen here, our technicians, and all the people who watch this and see it and hear it. And as my mother said to me about that nice piece of wood, I add a prayer that they will receive what we had to give them.